Hi everyone, thank you for joining in today. We're going to start very soon. I'm just waiting for Poonam to join in and more people to join this conversation. Thank you all for joining us today. We'll actually start around 5 o'clock. I appreciate all of you who decided to log in a bit earlier. Hi, Pooja. I think Poonam is only going to join in after 5. I can see that it's not 5 yet. So we'll just give it 5 more minutes. More people are joining in now. Thank you to all those who've joined in already. We are waiting for Poonam to join in so that we can start the conversation on flooring trends in design. It would be great if you have any questions to leave your questions in. We'll be happy to address them as we go along the conversation. Hi. I will probably just text Poonam once and ask her to join in. I don't think she's logged in yet. We'll just wait for a couple of more minutes. In the meanwhile, if you have any questions on flooring, on stone, anything at all, flooring, walls, you can join in. Can you hear me now? Can everybody hear me? I mean, somebody's just messaged that they can't hear me. If anybody who can hear me, send me a text and confirm whether I'm audible. Okay, great. So I am audible. Thank you. We'll wait for Poonam and other people to join in. I think whoever cannot hear, then maybe they should just sign out and sign in again and maybe start the live feed again. Thanks, Arjun. Great. Thank you, guys. I appreciate you all being patient. I think another couple of minutes and she should be here with us. Thanks for sharing your questions, Pooja. We'll address them as soon as we have the first bit of the conversation over. Okay, Poonam has joined in. I'll wait for her. Just take about 5 more minutes, maybe.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
I need to adjust my...
Yes, you will need to adjust your camera because we can't see. Yeah.
Wait. Is this okay? Oh, that's going to be wrong.
That's horizontal.
Actually, I'm trying to come in from the iPad because with the phone, it's not the best. Is this okay? Yeah. You want me to still go?
A little bit maybe a little bit up would help. Or you can move. Yeah, you can sit like that.
Yeah, I get more comfortable that way.
Yeah.
So yes. I'm just gonna turn off this. I was just chatting with Sejal actually.
Yeah, okay, great.
Yeah.
So, Sunny, people have been waiting to hear you.
Yes, hi
And
people, how are you?
we have questions already. So, what I'm going to do is, I am going to just start the conversation right away without any delay so that we can address as many questions as we can later. I'll give, I mean, although everybody here knows you, and I think that's the reason why they're here to hear you talk, but I'll still introduce you. And so, with an experience of over a decade, AM/PM Designs is the brainchild of Akash Mehta and Poonam Mehta. The firm was incubated with the purpose to create structures that are a blend of unfathomable imagination, creativity, and ethereal design. Poonam's phenomenal designing sense and Akash's exceptional expertise in lighting design has taken the studio to a crescendo with various international and national awards. Within a very short span, AM/PM Designs has come to be recognized as an acclaimed design firm that combines light and luxury design to deliver awe-inspiring projects and space solutions. Known for the luxurious homes that you do, they all exude a signature style character. And down to the last tile, their unforgiving eye for detail ensures that the client's vision is percolated to the last nook. So with that fabulous
Thank you so
art
much. You put it
profile,
all together very well.
I will just straight away, start with our theme for today is, of course, exploring trends in 2020, right? My first question would be that, you've been around for a while. How do you think that trends in flooring have changed in the last few years?
You know, the Indian flooring covering industry itself has seen a drastic, I think, change and progress. There's been a lot of innovation in technology, be it marble, be it tiles. You can see now you get these extremely large tiles, which were something that none of us could dream of, you know, a couple of years back. So there is, I think, just so much progress that one has done in the industry. It's as emerging as any other material. In the construction industry. So it's amazing how it's transformed. I think kudos to technology for what is happening. And we designers have also become, I think, experimental ever since then. And we've accepted the technology. And of course, there's been awakening to an education that actually led to all of this. So I'm glad it's a good mix of everything. And I think even the scale of project, people now, even the clients demand, there's also the demand, right? The clients also demand a good maintenance-free, you know, also they want something that's going to be laid and forgotten about. So there are, I think, a lot of demands. And because of that, there has been emerging new materials. So
I
I
think,
think
yeah,
it's
the new materials are what are sort of taking us all by surprise, and it's all every day there is something new that you find, and there's new, and I think that is what keeps the profession engaged and excited. So yeah, like you said, hats
I
off to
mean, hats off for technology, and also, like, as for us as designers, there is something all the time, like you mentioned, no? Every fair or every some every ex every 2 months there's something new. So you know you're just kind of engaging and understanding new materials, and you also want to use them. And it's amazing how you can do engineering and take that risk to try something new for your project.
So do you see that? I mean, sorry, I'm going to pick you on what you said right now. Do you think that as more and more newer materials are coming into the market, designers are also becoming more experimental as compared to what their approach was like maybe 2 decades ago or 3 decades ago?
No, I think, see, a designer, I wouldn't say I love my design. I love all the designers back in there. I admire the kind of work they've done. You're putting me at a fix right now. But I think, you know, the in, even looking at the past, look at maybe 3 decades back, like you're saying, inlays were in, and amazing inlay work used to be there, and it's come back. My own home, my dad had constructed maybe 30 years ago, and we have this brass inlay going through the house. And now, of course, it's all back in trend. So, you know, that it's like fashion, everything that it does come back. But of course, it comes back with better technology and better methods of application.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Thanks for sharing your insights. So, according to you and your experience, when you pick out flooring for a particular space, what are the qualities of stone that you look at? You know, what are the elements that you're looking at? What are the primary principles that you apply?
I think I got your question. Let's say we get a project, and there are maybe one or at least 3 points that I think really matter. One is we mix a lot with materials. So really understanding materials. How I do a project is we have a massive library in my office, and I've dedicated a complete room for just surfaces. So anything that's new, that material has to be in my office for me to kind of, so I pull out a tray and I kind of formulate my design. I put the materials together and see how the entire design evolves. And that's how I come to a conclusion, okay, this is what my flooring should ideally be. Of course, keeping two more things in mind, I think, would be client's budget. What is the budget of the client? You know, you can't choose something that is extremely expensive, like especially with marbles. There is a huge range of materials. And even if you take a cream color stone, there is another range of materials. So you can be very smart and you don't have to spend so much amount, but yet come up with something. So that, I think, derives a lot of information to, okay, fine, this would be suitable. Another thing would be timelines. If I know that this project needs to be finished in like 3 or 4 months, I can't take something as a difficult stone to be laid in a project, because that will take only just that laying will take about 1 month or 2 months to kind of. So sourcing locally also becomes a good point. If I'm in Pune and if I have to tell my client for a project which he wants to finish in 3 months, there's no point traveling all the way to another city and sourcing materials. All these things are the practical solutions, but I think that kind of eventually derives the decision of choosing the material.
It is the practicality that counts eventually. I think clients also, they don't want to spend unnecessarily only because, you know, I think most clients are informed today to focus on these
very
sort of
informed. Very informed. Sometimes
too informed. Yeah.
But it's only for the good. It's amazing how, you know, today with a client, I can just have like a design conversation. Earlier it would just be with, you know, trying to explain them the whole thing. Now they understand, they're in the zone with us. So with all the Pinterest and everything that has come, in a bad way or a good way, but
an engaged client will always add on to the design process, right?
If a
client is not engaged, is not giving feedback, there's no brief, I think you would not enjoy the project as much. You would have a free hand, but then you can never sort of, you know, justify what the potential of the project is.
True. So I mean, too much.
Having an engaged
too much
client
of,
also helps.
That's what I said. Too much of a free hand is also bad, because then eventually he just says, yeah, you do anything, but that's not, you need a direction. You know, when we take up projects, we tell our client that the first month is, I said, this is knowing you. This month is called knowing you. And he's like, oh, what are you saying? I said, I need to know you guys. I need to know you, your wife, your kids. And this is because
how
this
you
is
live.
Your home. This is your home and what you like and what you, and they kind of sometimes just feel too overwhelmed. Like, really? You want to know all of that? Because I think that's very important. With even choosing a flooring, it's important what they like, what color they'll want to feel. Are they the, you know, the rustic kinds, or they like smooth finishes? It's very, very important.
Absolutely. And then obviously that informed process drives the design output as well.
Yeah, yeah.
This is what informs the design output.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Obviously, you do a lot of luxury homes, right? You are known for
yeah.
all the work that you do in this luxury residential segment. What are the trends there? You know, what are people doing right now?
You know, I'm a big sucker for marble, but that's why I feel that. Okay, there's a lot of emotion. I think any material that you lay on the floor, it has to talk to you. I mean, when you go to a marble yard and you're just looking at stones, I tell my clients that if you feel like, oh my God, this is like an art, like it's something that I would like to use, or it just looks good, just stop and stare at it for some more time, and then eventually it gets it. If you absorb it and it kind of talks to you, this is the marble for you. And this particular marble that we're talking, anything, it's so unique because it has a character of its own. It's natural. And in the end, when you lay it, it's personal to you. So I think that's my highlight. And of course, there's so many. Are you talking about trends in flooring?
And even otherwise, you know, how is stone used? I mean, of course, there's flooring and there's artwork and there's walls. But how
yeah.
else are people sort of using? Because I know most people do love stone, right? So how
right,
do they
right.
So where
See,
are you finding stone?
I think the most important aspect sometimes when you kind of divide, you know, when you say what is most important when you're talking about a three-dimensional figure, it's the flooring, it's your walls, and it's then the ceiling. So this is the way I structured it. So flooring kind of grounds the entire project. It kind of either gets the warmth or it gets coldness. It kind of sets your first feeling of the space itself. So that's, I think, flooring wise, it's very important. And if we're talking about trends, I think wooden, look at the kind of flooring options that have come in the market, laying them in those patterns of herringbones in chevron, in large planks. You know, back then they were just wood which would come in like 4 feet by 6 inch kind of thing, and now you have extremely large size planks which make the space look larger, because then you're not doing too much of a grid, and then playing with these abstract designs on with wood itself is a brilliant idea. So wood,
right.
And of course, like I said, tiles, oh my God, there is ample of options. So if someone has a budget, listen, we do have projects where we have budgets. It's not always high-end luxury. So, and of course, like we said, luxury is like a state of mind, even in design. Every home could be luxurious, doesn't have to be a very expensive marble. But,
of course.
Yeah, you agree? You agree? So, like you said, we're talking about tiles. There are absolutely amazing prints, patterns. They also look like they're inlaid marble. So there is a very good substitute to using marble itself. So I guess tiles can be like a great substitute for, and they can do amazing dramatic sets for, you know, even bathrooms and stuff. They kind of create an amazing drama in different spaces. So, and I personally blend a lot of materials in my surface. So I play with a lot of geometry and pattern with marble, and I think when you do a contrast with two materials, like if it's a darker stone and a lighter stone, it comes in beautifully. And one thing I think should remember when you're doing patterns is just typically how we do work on AutoCAD and we lay out the pattern, make sure the proportions are right. Once you get the proportion right, the entire pattern gets very, very, you know, it just sets so well in the house. And, you know, nowadays clients are also very, I think, like you said, informed, and they're okay to experiment on floorings. And as a part of their homes, earlier it used to be only maybe for hospitality, it would be for commercial spaces because they wanted it fun and things. But homes, they said, "Nee, ek hi marble laga do," you know, like. So this, I think the trend, people, they have accepted that, okay, let's do different kind of inlays. Let's play with different floors. We can divide the space into different materials. So that, I think the trend is great, and we should totally use it to, yeah.
Also, I think people are at in homes, everybody's become very aware of their private space versus the public space. And that's defined by their individual interests, right? So I think that's where opportunities are immense for designers because you can find something for to every sort of everybody's individual tastes and requirements, which obviously leaves a lot of exploration for materials. And like you were talking about amalgamation of materials and blending two or three materials together. Would you like to share a couple of examples where you have used maybe an odd combination of stones, like an unconventional combination that people don't tend to use, but you had a client and you know where you could mix, I don't know,
You know,
like a whole.
I can just think of the most risky material that I made. I chose a marble, I chose a wood, and I chose an onyx and a metal, and I have infused it into a pattern, and that has been used in my own cabin in my office. And that was the only risk, you know, where I've said, okay, this is if I can, I need to take a risk, I need to do it myself, you know. So that's laid beautifully in my office. And it looks absolutely stunning. I wish I'll try. I think I'll share the picture to you, and then we can further
After this, maybe you could share it in one of your stories or posts and tag A Class
tag.
Express so that people
Yes.
see. Because see, the idea is that sometimes, even as designers, we can't imagine, we can't fathom what two contrasting materials could do together,
Right.
right? It's like a
Right.
juggle of sorts, you know, where a
Yeah.
whole really sort of highly polished marble together can still do wonders. It depends on,
Yeah,
you know,
and
how.
even sometimes a mat and a sheen, they look fab. So we are
Fabulous.
taking one material, we are taking one black stone, and I have done like a chevron with a mat and a gloss. So it alternates and it looks beautiful. We're doing this in a project in Chennai, and I think it's something unique. Like you, I think that just the character of a sheen and not a sheen also looks beautiful.
Fabulous. Yeah. Great, great. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
So also, you know, in a lot of your projects, you obviously deal with heavy lighting, right? How do you manage to keep your flooring trendy, right, and look good while keeping the glare away?
You know, it's not the flooring that needs the change. It's really playing with clever lighting. When you see if a surface is shiny and the marble especially has the gloss, it has to reflect materials, and with the light, of course, it becomes even more predominant. So what ideally one should do is we play really well and clever with, thanks to Akash, we have total technical support. So washing it with like wall washers, you get amazing filters with these lights where the glare is cut off. And somehow the space, when you wash the walls with light, the space just starts having a larger perspective. And then eventually washing. So the glare, like you said, how do you cut off glare? That's the only best solution to do that.
Interesting. So
Yeah.
you can make spaces be non-reflective in the way you use your lighting, right?
Yeah.
Wow. Interesting. Very interesting. I think I'm sure a lot of people go and pick the stones accordingly, right? And then
Yeah, because like a lot marble especially, it does eventually after polish and things like that, and a lot of white stones and cream stones have a lot of reflection to it, any marble for that matter. So then you can't kind of say that, hey, I'm going to be doing a matte coat to it. Of course, there are amazing trends to having a leather finish to it and multiple finishes in marble nowadays. But then if you do have a gloss marble, then you play clever with the lighting.
Interesting. Okay, my last question for today, before we move on to the questions that the audience has for you, is you know, commercial work, residential work, hospitality work. What do you think are simple basic materials that work across the board? What would be your recommendations?
You know, let's talk. I think category. If you're like
Yeah,
looking at it,
sure.
sometimes when I mean commercial, there is a lot of high traffic areas, and then you need to play safe in those areas where you definitely opt for marble or tile. because they're really strong materials. You can also go for quartz, which is again a very strong material, and it plays very well for high traffic zones. Then you have the inside working spaces where you're talking about acoustics. Then you have carpets, which what colors and what patterns that you are getting in the market, one can go absolutely playful because offices and commercial spaces need that positive energy all the time, and you can go playful and colorful there. Then you have wooden floorings, which is again, I think, a unity for residential or all kinds of floorings, where we spoke about the different patterns that are available. But residences, I think, definitely something that's going to be timeless and never going to go out of trend is going to be marble. And of course, you get these absolute gorgeous large size tiles, which kind of create less of a grid. So then automatically it just looks, you know, large. The space starts looking bigger. So that's a very good idea for living and public areas. I think I've kind of covered it all, right?
Yeah, I think you have all three different. So I think there's everybody who needs a quick half an hour session on what stones to use or what surfaces to use. I think they can just session again
and for start. Outdoor. I was sorry, we didn't mention outdoor. And outdoor, you have amazing Indian stones, amazing textures on them. I personally love Kota, and I kind of do variety of patterns in them. And you can kind of play with them now with different sizes. So that's my new thing. Another project that we're doing in Indore, where the entire project is raw and rustic, and my client basically doesn't. So the entire floor is Kota. At some point, we've also broken it into IPS, which is that concrete laying.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
So, and in that, we have infused metal. So we have taken the metal and kind of done a pattern in that. We've created borders of it and a grid with brass. So another very good hint with what is good with residential interiors, I think, is opt for and take metals and please infuse them in your flooring. It creates so much drama, and maybe simple grids or simple borders also kind of enhance the space. So I think I use a lot of brass in the flooring, and it really kind of changes the way you just look at a typical marble flooring.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I am going to first take questions on this platform, and then I have one last question for you before we close the session. Okay. I think somebody had sent a question, but I can't see them. So I'll just start from the beginning. Do you prefer Indian marble or imported?
You know, marbles can be coming from any kind of source. It's really, like we said, it has to talk to you. If you are going to pick up a stone, of course, you have very variety of issues where you have budgets, you have a lot of things to think about. But when you're looking at a stone, it just has to fit into the space. You just have to, you know your space. And then when you look at a marble, it just has to merge within. And you know that this is going to really add character to the space. It's like looking at art. So Indian, Italian, I'm okay. Yeah.
Yeah. It's driven by personal choice as well.
Yes.
And budget. Everything else, right? And
yeah.
Where you are in context, and you know, local, whether it's a local marble or it's an imported, it depends on all of that.
There are amazing stones that you get in the south, and again, to a lot of different kind of stones that you get in Rajasthan and up north. So again, if you're there locally, looking at materials is a brilliant idea, and then you can create so much more with just maybe fusing two different patterns.
Also, the crafts are used to working with the local materials.
Yeah.
So you can really optimize their skill sets as well, right? And that,
yeah,
I think, does with that.
Yeah.
Okay, so Pooja has a question that nowadays, which marble is preferred to use for bungalows and homes? So I think you've already answered that. You've already responded to that. I will move on and see. I think there are some more questions. What do you prefer, natural stone or tiles?
I
personally, what do you prefer?
Personally, Yeah, personally, I would definitely recommend. I personally like Marvel, and I think it brings in a lot of characters, especially to your public spaces. When you're doing bedrooms, I understand that we fill up the bedrooms with a lot of furniture anyway. There's so much of functionality that is going on there. There is the bed, the side tables, the wardrobes, and the TV units that you eventually kind of hardly see the flooring. So then you can totally opt for a very simple tile, which kind of just plays along very well and grounds the entire space together. So I think that is a good way. So that's how I do. I balance my budgets also like that. So the public areas, like we spoke, are you can go a little flamboyant and go, stretch a little, and then eventually you kind of play smart with your toilets and your bedrooms.
Great. Abhishek has a question. Does price matter in the selection of stone?
Of stone, of course, we have. I mean, price. But again, like I've had clients who've set a very strict budget for the flooring, and you said we are. And I also make sure that I hold their hand. If this is not something we need to look at, this is very expensive, and then they just stop in front of the marble. I mean, because see, this is like you said, this is something. It's a stone. You love it. It's a piece of art. You just want it, and you sometimes can't put a price tag to it. So there are situations where we've had a client saying, "You do what you want, but I want this marble." So then you rework the entire budget.
I think it's also to do with, like we were discussing earlier, right? Personal choices. If a
Right.
stone resonates with you and your personality, whether as an individual or as a family, you would pick it, right? Because this is what
Right.
it symbolizes of you. So it's
Right.
almost like you pick an item of clothing, which is very personal. It's defined to your taste and all of that. So of course it's like a, I mean, it's a style quotient for most people. I think a lot of people have loved your point about brass inlay and the metal inlay. So there are a lot of compliments there, and a lot of great work. I'm just going through those comments. Yeah, somebody asked, how can you catch if there is a crack in the marble or not?
When I was learning, and I would say in the initial days, I would be so scared of understanding if it's a crack that can be treated. There are several kind of some little tiny cracks that can be treated, and so I would take my marble kadiyawala with me for the selections, or post that, and make sure that every marble is checked by him, and I'll make sure that he says, okay, this is very good and safe. This whole lot is great. We should take it. Because see, there's a lot of money that is involved. The clients are going to pay, and
Smart
it's
thing to do. Yeah, people
yeah.
need
So
to know.
I did that as a practice. I still sometimes, when it's a large project, I now, of course, with through them, I would say my most of the learning has been at site. When I used to work with when I was working at TP at Talati Panthaki, I remember sitting at site and eating with my carpenters. I used to sit and eat with them their food and all, and just spend the whole day. And they know, I'm sure if they're listening, some of them know what the kind of work I used to sit and do with them. Just ask them silly questions, EAQ, just because the kind of knowledge they have and they can give you, it's immense. So I think that's do that. If that's a trick, just take that as a take your marble layer, because he will have so much knowledge and he can pick up the right flaws, sometimes you call it in a marble, but most of it sometimes is the natural character also of the marble.
Very interesting. That makes a lot of sense. Okay, then Yash has a question. What flooring should we consider in offices?
See, the entire for the office, there has to be some acoustic element to it. If it's not your ceiling, it has to be your floor. So you need to be just smart on what your surfaces are. You get amazing wall panels that come, which are acoustic, and you can create some kind of. So you, because of the open, of course, now trends are changing, and how we're going to be looking at offices is completely a complete different topic, and we should probably keep that for a separate discussion. But what I'm trying to say is, if you are maybe doing acoustic ceilings, then you can of course take a tile. As your base, or you can take wooden flooring as your base. But if you're looking at you don't have any other, then carpet becomes the only choice, and it's an excellent acoustic material.
Okay, people are also asking you for internships. I think you can just write to Poonam for that.
Right, yeah, you can DM us, please.
Yeah. What about terrace areas and coffee rooms? What sort of flooring would you recommend?
Terrace again, like anything that is anti-skid for the obvious reasons. And again, you can actually do some, you can play with two different materials and create a pattern and make that the most exciting space. And then of course you add the greens and of course all of that, but the flooring could just be, and like we spoke, could be an Indian stone and just keep it as raw as possible and grout it, maybe space it out and not grout it also, and that also looks brilliant.
Yeah, that looks really nice actually.
That looks really nice, yeah. So,
Also, Zeno, Poonam had answered this question earlier about outdoor spaces. Maybe she can refer to that bit of the conversation later. Also, okay, Lal, I think this is the last question. No, there's two more. With the new trend of cladding marble on walls, what is your take on this? Cladding
Cladding
stones.
house. It's not, I would say it's not a new trend. It's been there for years. And even look at the entire, earlier, the entire walls and all of that was cladded with the stone. So if you look at our palaces and going traveling to Jaipur,
Yeah,
Jodhpur, and things like that, it's the stone
the
was
stone
the
cladding.
entire surface. Yeah. So, and then there was this amazing, beautiful detailing and grouts and things like that. So I think now we have move to plastering and paint and things like that. So I think it's not a trend, it's been there and it's going to be there forever.
Okay. Another one from Keetana. What color combination do you think is future?
What color? Sorry?
What color combination is futuristic? In stones, what is a color combination that would look futuristic? Or a combination of stones that would look futuristic?
I
I
think
think.
futuristic, I think when you, whenever we talk about futuristic or extremely modern kind of spaces, you're looking at absolutely clean spaces. So you can take, like use of quartz or something that just has absolute no character, and then you can just kind of lay them at a stretch, and that probably is futuristic. You're looking at colors, whites, grays, blacks. I think these are the, that's what I can think of. And of course, you can go completely trendy and go for a red or something, but I'm not sure. I won't do that.
Then I think I have two more questions here. Which marble is the best for cladding for a religious project?
For a religious project. Wow. When I
Definitely white and Indian. Somebody's really testing you.
huh?
I think
And except
somebody's
for white
really
and
testing
Indian,
your
she,
knowledge.
so has she eliminated white and Indian?
No, preferably white and Indian.
So they want, oh, they're saying
White
which one?
Indian, which white Indian marble is, which would you recommend it for a religious project for cladding?
I think you get these. I have recently used like this white tassos. It's not Indian, but it looks beautiful. It's just stark white. It's absolute stark white, and it's a Greek stone. That's something I just use, and it kind of takes in also inlays very well. I've kind of put again a little bit of brass to the element. We've made these lotus cutouts and then kind of laid them here and there in the floor. And then eventually that kind of lotus went up on the back wall as well. So Indian, I'm not too sure, but Greek would be good.
Okay, totally off the topic of stones, what is the comparison between wallpaper and paint wall or and painted walls?
What
Between
was it?
wallpaper and painted walls, what do you prefer?
When I do, when we really do, I love wallpapers. I think they bring out a lot of character, especially these amazing, we do that a lot with textured, like the silk and jute and things like that, because it doesn't even feel, it feels very, very real. But it has proper vinyl backing, and it's something to stay. But I would not do that in a traffic area. When I mean a traffic or public area, it's even passages and things like that in the living area where kids or people just kind of touch walls. It's like a human psyche of doing that, and then eventually they could get dirty soon. But maybe places where you can't approach them and you get a great visibility, then wallpaper is very good. So I do a lot of mix of paint and wallpaper, but wallpaper is maybe I would say 30%. And a lot of larger spaces we do paint, and you get amazing colors and textures that you can in paint as well. So much in paint. So much in paint has again, that's another kind of, I think, a chapter itself, where what all has come in paint.
Okay, last question for today. What elements do you consider when you design a foyer for a bungalow?
That's my most favorite space, and the most you can absolutely go crazy designing that kind of, you can do something dramatic to the floor, and you can kind of add something to the space or the wall, and one accent kind of furniture really makes the space, because this is the first, you call it the first impression to your home. It has to be welcoming. Accessorize it a lot. So flooring, go trendy. You can, do a, I mean, I, that's one place I really go with an inlay or a thought of creating something dramatic with the floor itself.
Great.
Leather walls, can I read it? Leather walls or
Or
wooden
wooden
walls?
walls. Yeah.
Wooden walls, a lot more. I'm just thinking out of my maintenance kind of thought of maintenance to it. Leather, again, you need to be very, very clever on where, which city you're doing this project in. Yeah, so if I'm doing a project in Chennai where it's too much humidity and too much sweating, you may just not want to do that. Wood again is a beautiful material, amazing warmth, and you get varied colors in that as well. A really light wood also kind of just does magic to the space. And of course, I also really like the dark, extremely dark wood, because that kind of does the drama, and it. Yeah, and you can
That's
go shiny,
contrast.
matte,
Yeah.
yeah, all of that. But you get, if you really want leather walls, then you have substitutes to using wallpaper that has, these leather-looking wall coverings, which are brilliant. And you can also kind of wrap this so thick that you can kind of wrap it up and make it look like leather panels itself. So I'm giving you a substitute to leather.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I am going, last question for us is, it's not really a question, it's a design tip for anybody who is doing up their home or working with flooring. So
Design
what would
tip.
your, yeah, but we use this hashtag of let's talk design. So what would your
Right.
one tip be?
Guys, just don't be afraid to use patterns and create geometry with your floor. I think that's a brilliant way of looking at flooring, especially in, like for example, like we just said, foyer areas or a powder bathroom or something where you have like this beautiful passage to kind of, so go experimental, take the risk, and that I think is my design tip for flooring. And I earlier I would have that, and there's the biggest myth that one says, no, like a dark material or a dark marble makes the space look smaller. I disagree with it. I completely disagree with it. It's the way again you play with lighting. Of course, the interiors, you need to look at a lot of other elements. So if you wash your walls and you kind of do a clever lighting, you can totally pull off with a dark surface of marble as well. The dark grays, and
Yeah, thank
yeah,
you.
like
That's
you
a
have
good
bronze
use.
Armani, you have all of these marbles that looks, and because marble has a reflection, a reflective quality, even tiles, they come with amazing gloss. So there is anyway so much depth in the floor that you can go dark. You can play, and please don't think that, oh my God, if it's a dark flooring, it's going to start looking very small. And then, so yeah, contrast, play with contrast. That's another very good idea for, I can see Akash writing, thanks, Poonam.
So this has been very useful for everybody. As much as I said, it's the last question. I have Zeno asking for one more question, so I will take it up.
Okay.
Floating for, I don't understand the question, but it's, I think it says a floating slab for my coffee room on terrace. I really like your taste. Could you
Floating?
suggest?
Sorry,
I think floating slab. I think that's what she means.
thanks.
Maybe
And
she can
last
actually
question.
hear you, or maybe she can DM you and ask you. Please respond
For
to
a
her message.
coffee room on terrace, as I really like your taste. For a coffee room on terrace. Yeah, I think please DM me if you have any more
Yeah.
questions. I'd be happy to answer. Let me know.
Yeah. Okay, great. So thank you so much, Poonam. It was really nice talking to you. I
Thank you,
think your
Kanya.
ex you, thank you for sharing all your experience with us. I think that's been the most useful aspect of this conversation. People have been
Yeah,
learning
thank
from
you.
that. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.